Hi everyone, and welcome back to Level 2 of Lesson 1. In this video, we'll cover the basics of starting a formula. Additionally, we'll cover the sum, average, min, max, count, and count A formulas. In this level, we'll pick up on a new spreadsheet that centers around doing a material analysis for our company TZ Edge. What we have here is a number of components that each shoe takes to manufacture. We have different options for the different components. For example, for the original option, these are the raw material costs. For the textured leather shoes, these are the costs, and for the high tops, these are the costs of materials required to make the shoes. What we're going to discuss in this level are functions and formulas. I'm sure that you're mostly familiar with formulas. To begin a formula in Excel, you click in a cell and start it with an equal sign, and then type your formula like 23 plus 56. Then when you hit enter, tab, or click anywhere outside the cell, Excel runs the calculation and shows you the result. The result is displayed, but the actual data in the cell is up here in the formula bar. So that's the beginning of formulas. What Excel has done is taken popular or common or complicated formulas and built them into what we call functions. You've probably seen the most common function, which is called sum. It goes something like this: equals, sum, left parentheses, and then the numbers that you want to sum up. For instance, 12, 34, 56, and then close it up with a right parentheses. Hit enter, and the calculated answer from the formula is displayed. Cool. There's your first function. We can do the sum function here in the materials total row to add up the total cost of the materials here in the original option column. Equals sum, left parentheses, then click on the cells that we want to add. It's always better to include the references to the cells rather than typing in the values of these cells for two reasons. One, it's quicker to reference cells, and two, if we reference the actual cells, then if the values in those cells change, our function recalculates using those updated numbers. Notice that I just added the cells that contain numbers into my sum function. There are a couple problems with doing it this way. The first problem rears its ugly head if someone enters in a value for the toe support brace. See, the materials total does not change? Fail. Another problem can surface if you add a row into here for an additional raw material. Let's add a row for an anti-stink charcoal insert. And put in a price of $2.22. See how the material does not change? Rather than adding all of the cells individually to your sum function, a better way would be to highlight the first cell and then drag down to the last cell that you want added. Now if we add yet another row for the arch support pump and add a price to it, this additional raw material cost will now be included in the total. That's a lot better way of doing it. As you'll find in Excel, there are often multiple ways to do the same thing. On the home ribbon, notice the Autosum icon here next to the sigma sign. If I put the cursor in the cell where I want the function to reside and then click on this icon, a number of handy common functions are here for your convenience. In addition to sum, you'll also notice there are average, count, max, min, and the dreaded more functions. If we select sum, Excel will place the formula in that cell and attempt to guess what cells you want to include in your sum function. This works really well when all the cells that you're summing are filled with numbers. Let's try it on this column where there are some holes in the data. See what the wizard did to us here? It gets to the first empty cell and then stops. Let's fix this by grabbing hold of the cell range here and expanding it out to include all of the cells that we want summed. While I'm here, I want to show you a handy shortcut that we could use when we want to repeat a formula to adjacent cells in the same row, or in this case, the same column. If I'm sure that this formula is correct, I can hold my mouse over the bottom right-hand corner of the cell and see how the mouse changes shape. This is now called the fill handle. This is an indication that it's now able to copy the cell's contents to an adjacent cell. This is sometimes referred to as filling right. When we do this, it automatically copies the formula from the C column to the D column and automatically assumes that you want to change the cells added from C to D as well. See the formula here in column C and now in D? Excel is smart enough to know that if the formula here in C adds up these cells in column C, the chances are that you'll want the same pattern if you copy that formula from column C to column D. This works because of what Excel calls relative referencing. The formula in this cell refers to these 10 cells immediately above it, so when we copy the formula from C13 to D13, the new formula in D13 will refer to the similar 10 cells immediately above it. By default, it tries to be consistent. These cells are relative to this cell, so when you copy the formula to column D, Excel makes these cells relative to this formula. This is why the default behavior in Excel is called relative referencing. We'll get into this more in the later video. Let me undo this last formula fill by hitting Ctrl Z, or the undo button, and show you some additional fill functionality. You can also access the fill commands from out here on the home ribbon under editing. See here that you can fill down, right, up, and left, even across worksheets, but we'll get into that at a later time. If you want to know now, Google Excel fill across worksheets. Let me undo our previous fill and show you that there are also some keyboard shortcuts for filling right. Control plus the R key. When it comes time to do it, you can also fill down by clicking on the Control plus D key, D for down, R for right. Not that we want to do it for this business case, but Control D or fill down is often handy if we want to copy a series of numbers or formulas down the page. If you put a 1 here and fill down, it just puts a 1 in all of the cells. But if we give Excel a clue that there's a pattern that we want it to follow, it's pretty smart and will pick up on that pattern. Let's undo this and put a 2 here. Now highlight the 1 and the 2 and move the mouse to engage the fill handle and then drag that range down and ta-da! Again, not applicable in this case, but still pretty cool stuff. Getting back to our case, let me delete all this fun and frivolity over here and go back up here and talk about the very common average function. You can go to this cell and start our formula with the equal sign, as always, and then type in the first few letters of the word average and let Excel autofill the rest of the word. We can then hit the tab key to select the average function, or you can double-click on it. The function then reveals what it needs in order to calculate the average. It looks like it needs a series of numbers or an array or range of cells separated by commas, or in this case, just one array of numbers. As an alternative, we can use the shorthand way of going back to Home and then select Average from the Autosum shortcut tool. Now that we have this formula correct, we can grab a hold of the fill handle and drag this average function down to wherever the end of our range is. We don't want dollar signs on each of these, so I'll delete them by formatting them appropriately. A couple more functions that I want to introduce you to are the min and max functions. If I want the minimum price of all of these components calculated in this cell here, I click on the cell and then type in equals min left parentheses, then select the entire range of cells from B3 to D12, and then close those parentheses. Notice that this works for not just one row or column, but an entire range or array of cells. Let me repeat the process for the max function by using the wizard back on the home ribbon. Select max, then select the correct range, and there you go. Now let me show you two more functions, count and count A. Let's start with count A. Count A is what you want to use when you want to count cells that contain all kinds of values. As long as the cell is not empty, it will be counted. So let's do it. Equals count A. Notice the pop-up description of the formula that we are about to use. Now type in the left parentheses, then select our range of cells and close the parentheses. 10. That looks right. I can do the same for numerical values as well. Let me fill this formula to the right one. Grab the fill handle here and see if we get the right answer. 8. That looks good as well. What happens if we have text in here? Let's put in NA for not applicable here. See if the formula renders 9 now? We just want to count the numeric values, so that's not correct, and we're in need of a different function. We can fix this by using the count function. Let's look at this function and take out the A, and now we have a count formula that accurately counts up all of the numeric values in the range. Now that I'm confident that I have what I need in this cell, I'll copy it across to column C and D to finish this part up. Let's add the word count over here, and then do a little formatting to this area so that the summarization area of the page jumps out at us a little over the actual underlying data. That's it for level 2. We'll see you in the next video for level 3.